Mr. Speaker, by the moment I'm sick, when first speaker of opposition comes out to the podium and gives us an 8-minute speech upon why the US is so bad, we think that is the moment the side of opposition has to lose in this debate. Because this debate, in essence, Mr. Speaker, is not a debate of whether US is a nice actor or not, but it's rather a comparison between the US and the UN in the very first place, and that is the reason why we say that we are so proud to propose a side proposition. But before we go into the actual refutations and retakes of their arguments, let's first consider the model that they presented in this debate. Even though this was a value debate, the model that they proposed was that under the authorization of the UN, even though it's not the last resort or not, it does not matter. And so only if the UN gives authorization to the US, the US will have legitimacy to intervene in the very first place. Two major faults are defined with this model, Mr. Speaker. Because one, by the moment and style opposition says that these nations like the US or these liberal democracy nations can intervene whenever they want to, under the condition that they get authorization from the UN, even if it's not the last resort, we think that is the moment when they actually lower the bar in order to intervene in those nations. That's the moment when you have casualties, even in situations when you can resolve those conflicts using other alternatives like economic sanctions or diplomacy or whatnot. But two, the very fact that they already want some sort of change is a principal concession in which they already agree that the UN is not so efficient as they claim it to be. But by the moment they say that the United States has to get authorization from the UN in the very first place, what is literally the difference from the status quo, Mr. Speaker? So at the end of the day, what this debate actually boils down to is a comparison between the USA and the UN, and note the fact that they gave us literally no response upon our first speaker's metric of efficiency. Hence, we think that the side that proves to you about which side better saves the people on the ground, which side better kicks these corrupt dictatorships out of those conflict regions, is the side that actually takes this debate home at the end of the day. So before we go on to our arguments, let's first talk about their arguments and their refutations in the very first place. Because I think that there's a mainly really big question of which actor is better between the USA and the UN. Two reasons why side opposition tells us that the USA is not a good actor in the very first place. First reason about isolationism and how Donald Trump enters the USA into a phase where they do not wish to intervene into other nations. Yes, it is true that the USA is pulling themselves out of international treaties like the TPP or UNESCO or whatnot. But we think that it's also true that the USA still has an incentive in order to implement liberal democracies within conflict regions in the very first place. Even though you have a USA that's entering an isolation phase, we think that their primary incentive is to implement democracy within these nations because they do not want countries like the Soviet Union or China having their influence within these corrupt countries or these countries with autocrats, Mr. Speaker. And hence, that's the reason why even though the USA is entering this isolationist phase, they still have a primary incentive to kick the dictators out from these oppressive regimes in the very first place. The second reason that they give us is manipulation and the example of the Korean War. One, we gave you our first speaker, Mr. Speaker, gave you a very clear analysis upon why this manipulation is very unlikely to happen in the very first place. We told you that the countries like USA already care about their image in the very first place. After the Iraq War, the US literally receives an immense amount of backlash in the very first place. Two, we also told you all the voter interest. Before Bush is the president of the United States of America, he is still an American politician, Mr. Speaker. So that's to say, the primary incentive of Bush is to care for his own voters and to gain more voters so he can get re-elected or his party can get the benefits at the end of the day. And hence, when those people do very manipulated things like the Iraq War or whatnot, that's the moment when they get immense backlash from their own voters, because even if it benefits the United States both politically and economically, the voters do not want to shed blood on those conflict regions simply to gain a bit more cash, Mr. Speaker. So we say that because of these voter interests, these countries are very unlikely to be manipulated in the very first place. But final response, even though we concede to their own analysis that these countries like the US is going to be manipulative, that is still better than what's going to happen in the alternative, Mr. Speaker. Because consider the example that they give us, which was the Korean War. Yes, it is true that the US was involved in the Korean War for their own secular interests. But isn't that if the US did not intervene, we wouldn't have had South Korea in the very first place, right? We would have had rather a North Korea that literally came down to Jeju Island with their own troops backed up by the Soviet Union and China, Mr. Madam Speaker. So we say that considering the alternative, it's still better to have this selfish-minded US that actually wishes to implement democracy within these regions at the end of the day. Then let's go into a comparison upon why the actor of the UN is not so good as they's claim is to be. Three major reasons and also my extension included upon these points. Number one, we told you about how multilateral agreements are simply extremely ineffective. The fact that even within the Security Council, these member states within the P5 nations have the power to vote, to veto literally any resolution that they deem to be irrelevant to their own national interests, Mr. Madam Speaker. Hence, this directly goes against our metric of efficiency upon how these large multilateral entities like the UN is just simply ineffective in order to handle these conflict regions or these conflicts that happen within such nations at the end of the day. But two, even if within the UN you come to an agreement, Mr. Madam Speaker, you still have to make negotiations in order to make those agreements in the very first place. So for example, this may look like the United States negotiating with countries like the Soviet Union or China to give amnesty to certain dictators or certain individuals or politicians within these dictator regimes under the condition that the UN is going to invade or intervene in these nations, in these oppressive regimes, Mr. Madam Speaker. So even if inside the opposition's world, even if you have a world where you make such agreements under the UN, you necessarily have to make compromises and negotiations in which you have to necessarily decrease the efficiency of your strikes, of your interventions within these oppressive regimes in the very first place. Three, we also say that the UN less cares, the member states within the UN do not really care about the image of the UN itself, right? Because even though the member states are doing things that are in their own secular interests, the entity that actually gets the harm in their image is the UN, Mr. Madam Speaker. It's not the nation it's not the individual nation, but it's rather the collective of the United Nations. So hence, at the end of the day, we see that these nations really have nothing to lose at the end. But then there are another line of response come to all of these arguments was about accountability, about how America becomes the solely responsible entity when it comes to the US failing in their interventions. Number one, we see no reason why this is a bad thing in the very first place. And note that this also connects to our third argument about how America is an exclusive entity that is interested in benefiting these oppressed, in benefiting the people living in these oppressive regimes at the end of the day. Because by the moment that America becomes the solely responsible entity, Mr. Madam Speaker, that functions as an incentive for America to actually care about what's happening in these places at the end of the day. By the moment that America realizes that they are going to be solely responsible for whatever happens within these oppressive regimes or these conflict zones, that's the moment that America does not just leave after kicking the dictator out, but is rather incentivized to have long-term changes or constructive changes, like implementing an actual democratic regime into these places, about holding those democratic elections, those long-term beneficial policies that actually benefit the people living in the ground. Then that is what happens by the moment when America begins to acknowledge that they are going to be solely responsible for what they cause within these regions at the end of the day. So for all these reasons, let the motion stand.